Thursday have reported a number of cases of 7,251 of mucormycosis, and the fatality rate associated with this disease is 54%. So we are facing an epidemic in the middle of a pandemic situation. So in such a situation, to spread a true awareness and knowledge among dental students and clinicians, Focus MDS and Dentowoman have collaboratively organized this webinar. Focus is an educational institute offering complete classroom coaching and online training for postgraduate aspirants in the field of dentistry. And Dentowoman is an informative YouTube channel for dental students and NEET MDS aspirants. In the span of less than a year, we are a family of more than 10,000. If you are hearing this word, Dentowoman, for the first time, then you are just a step away. Go to the YouTube, search for Dentowoman, and you are there. Well, today for this webinar, we have two amazing speakers with us. So first, I would like to introduce Dr. Jerry Mammon. Sir has done her... as junior resident in Christian Dental College for 2 years, after which he worked as an international lecturer in University of Technology, Kingston, Jamaica for a year. In 2012, he was ranked first in CDC for post-graduation qualifying exam and ranked 169 in All India Entrance Exam. Sir joined for MDS in Periodontics in Government Dental College, Calicut, and post-PG worked as an assistant professor in Government Dental College, Trichur. He has been part of Focus Teaching Institute from its inception and has been teaching two non-clinical subjects and periodontology as well. So it will be our honor and pride to hear about this from you, Dr. Jerry.
Thank you so much for the kind introduction. So we will directly move on to the topic. So am I audible and clear to everybody?
Yes, sir.
Am I audible and clear to everybody?
Everything is good. You may go ahead.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Thank you. So the topic, like we discussed, is mucormycosis. And today we will see some of the most important points about mucormycosis. I will be discussing about the pathogenesis, the occurrence, and different types of mucormycosis. And Dr. Pravesh will be then continuing with the diagnosis and the treatment plan of it. Okay, to start off, mucormycosis is a serious but rare, relentless, destructive fungal infection caused by a group of molds called as mucormycetes. Okay, so it was earlier called as zygomycosis. Okay, but now the terminology has been changed and now it is referred to as mucormycosis. Now, moving on, we will just see the basic classification of mucormycosis, how it is classified, under what it is, so that you get a basic idea before even you move on to the pathology and everything. Okay, so it is classified under fungi. In kingdom, it is classified under fungi. And then in the phylum, it is classified as glomeromycota. Okay. And in the subphylum, it is classified as mucormycotina. Okay, so it's a fungi. In the phylum, glomeromycota. In the subphylum, mucormycotina. Now, there are different species that are classified under or identified under this mucormycotina. Okay, all of them are associated with different types of lesions in mucormycosis. But the most important one or the most prevalent one nowadays is your Rhizopus oryzae. Okay, so this is the most prominent one which we come across for, that causes mucormycosis. Okay, now moving on to the risk factors. So which all patients are prone to or at more risk in developing mucormycosis? Okay, so we will see which are those risk factors. The most important one is your diabetes mellitus. Okay, uncontrolled diabetes mellitus is actually now put as the number one risk factor for mucormycosis. And in those patients of diabetes mellitus who develop diabetic ketoacidosis are at a much higher risk. Okay, so that is your first factor, risk factor. The second one is hematological malignancies, especially your leukemias and your lymphomas. They are also associated with mucormycosis. Those patients who have leukemias and lymphomas are more prone to develop mucormycosis. Why? Because all these patients tend to develop this condition, that is your neutropenia. Neutropenia is nothing but decrease in the number of your neutrophils. So why is it so significant? Why is neutropenia so significant in mucormycosis? The answer is very simple. The first line of defense against mucormycosis is brought about by this neutrophils. These neutrophils are your first line of defense against your mucormycosis. Okay, they are the ones that attack the spores, and they are the ones that attack the hyphae. Once these spores germinate, they are the ones that attack these hyphae and destroy them. So if their count decreases, indirectly or directly, they are affecting the role of your immune system in controlling the fungi in your body or to eliminating the fungi in your body. Okay, so that is why neutropenia is very significant. Okay, then what are the other factors? You have patients who are on prolonged or long-term corticosteroid treatment, patients who had severe burns, immunodeficiency patient, organ transplant and stem cell transplant patients, and iron overload. Okay, hemochromatosis. So patients, again, iron overload is very, very important because, again, iron favors the growth of this fungal hyphae. Okay, as we come to the pathogenesis, we'll see. But again, the point here, why hemochromatosis or why iron load overload is significant is because it will aid in the growth of the fungal hyphae. So actually, it will, if your body or your blood serum has higher levels of iron, it will actually help the fungi to grow at a much faster rate. Okay, so I hope that is clear. Now moving on to the occurrence of the disease. Mostly it is present in your soil and in decomposing tissues. That is where you will find this fungi. Okay, and the most important point is it has the ability to produce spores. Why this is significant is because these spores are the ones which gain entry into either your nasal cavity, your sinus, or into your gastrointestinal tract. Okay, it can be either by inhalation, ingestion, or even inoculation into your skin through some cut or some burns. Okay, and once these spores gain entry, when the environment is favorable, they will start to germinate into the hyphae. So spores, very, very important. And it can cause different lesions in different sites in our body. Now we will see what is the method of transmission. Like I said, it can be due to inhalation of the spores, inoculation into your skin through any cuts, burns or anything, or ingestion of the spores from the environment through some food items. Okay, so that is how the fungus gain entry into your body. Now the question is it contagious? Does it spread from one patient to another? The answer is no. Mucormycosis can't spread between people or between people and animal. Okay, so only way is you inhale it or you ingest it or you get it inoculated into your skin. Now moving on to the pathogenesis. So now we will see how mucormycosis is gaining entry into your body and how it is affecting your systems or how it is causing damage and finally death in almost 50%. Mortality is almost 50%. Okay, so let's see, how does it start? So like we studied, in the environment, in decomposing tissues, in your soil, there are spores. These spores you inhale into your body, either it will stay inside your nasal cavity, inside your sinus, or it will move into your lungs. Okay, or in your skin, it can get inoculated by some penetrating injury. Okay, so the spores, now the first thing that has happened here is that the spores has gained entry into your body. Now, remember this, any foreign object that goes into your body, immediately your body will recognize it and it will start reacting against it. Okay, it will start reacting against it. How does your body defend? It is by causing was by starting inflammation in your body. That means your innate immune response start coming. Okay, just a minute. It's audible. Okay, I'm getting messages that it is not audible. Okay, so I hope it is clear. Okay, so as soon as these spores gain entry into your body will show inflammatory response. Why inflammatory response? It's a method of defense. Now, once there's inflammation, we know that the first cells to come to these sites are your neutrophils, PMNs, and your macrophages. What is their role? Their role is to come phagocytose these cells or these spores and remove them from your body so that it does not cause further damage. So your macrophages and your neutrophil, they will start phagocytosing the spores that have come into your body. But now in patients with those risk factors that we are talking about, patients who are on glucocorticoids or patients who have neutropenia, will this happen? No, this will be hampered because there are not enough neutrophils to go and attack these spores, or the neutrophils are not capable of removing them from our body. So then what happens? As the environment improves, this spores will germinate into the fungi. It will germinate into the fungi. That means it will start producing fungal hyphae. It will start producing fungal hyphae. Okay. Now, again, at this point, it is again your body's immune cells' duty to come again and attack these fungal hyphae. Again, these are foreign bodies. Again, it is recognized by your immune cells, like your neutrophils and macrophages. They will again come and they will try to destroy these fungal hyphae. They will again try to destroy these fungal hyphae. Again, now what is the problem here? Patients who are impaired, that means their immune system is impaired by glucocorticoids, by neutropenia, by hyperglycemia, and by iron overload, they are not able to fight this. So along with that, when there is an iron overload, that means there is increase of iron present in your body, what will that do? It will favor the growth of this fungal hyphae. It will favor the growth of this fungal hyphae. So basically, along with the neutrophils not able to kill these fungal hyphae, the iron is helping in the faster growth of this hyphae. So from here, it progresses into the hyphae because of all these problems. And from there, what is the final outcome once these hyphae start growing? Their major property is angioinvasion. They show angioinvasion. Now, what is that? It's nothing but these fungal hyphae has the ability to invade into your blood vessels and cause damage. What do? As soon as they get inside your blood vessels, they will cause hemorrhage, they will cause thrombosis, and finally, the blood flow to different organs, different tissues are blocked out. So there will be infarction resulting in necrosis of the tissue. The tissue will die out. Along with that, all these things are happening at a specific point. For example, inside your nasal cavity, inside your sinus, or within your lung. But since the hyphae has gained entry into your blood vessel, now there is a big problem that is awaiting us. That is, these will get traversed to different or disseminated to different parts of your body. That is where the major problem comes. The fungal hyphae, once they gain entry into your blood vessel, they will get disseminated to different organs. Which are organs? The organs that are highly supplied with your blood vessels, or high blood supply, that is your brain, okay, your kidney, your heart, your spleen, all the major organs will get affected. And one by one, there will be organ failure, resulting in multi-organ failure, finally resulting in death of the patient. Okay, and this doesn't happen over months. This is a very fast progressing disease. So that is why always they say the treatment plan or the whatever we do, it should be aggressive in nature. We should not delay anything because it is very fast moving fungal infection. Okay, so I hope the pathogenesis is clear. So now we know what is happening and how it attacks our system and what all cells play a role. Just neutrophils, why I talked about neutrophils, because they play the major role. There are many other immune cells which take part in removing this fungi, but the primary role is played by your neutrophils. Okay. So that is your pathogenesis. Now coming to different types of your mucormycosis. We'll see all the different types of mucormycosis that has been classified. Okay, now what are these? These are your, the first and the most important one for from dental point of view, it is our rhinocerebral mucormycosis. This rhinocerebral mucormycosis is now renamed as rhino-orbitocerebral mucormycosis, or it is in short form, they will put it as ROCM, rhino-orbitocerebral mucormycosis. Why? Infection starts in the nose, then it moves into your sinus, from there into your ethmoid bone, and from there directly into your brain. Okay, so that is the pathway, because easy pathway for it to spread, and that is why the term is now put rhino-orbitocerebral mucormycosis. Now, what is this? This is an infection in the sinus that spreads to the brain. Okay, very important. Most common in people with uncontrolled diabetes and people who have had kidney transplant. Okay, now how does the pathogenesis, like what we studied, spores gain entry into your nasal passage. They'll mature or germinate into the hyphae, and they will gain entry into your blood vessel, angioinvasion, causing thrombosis, infarction, and finally necrosis of the tissue. Now, what are the clinical features that we should look out for? One-sided facial swelling, headache. The patient will come with headache, nasal or sinus congestion. As it progresses a lot more, the patient will come with a black lesion on the nasal bridge or upper inside of the mouth, basically in the palatal region. The patient will come with a black ulcer. Okay, so that is one. And some kind of serosagnus, nasal discharge plus fever. Mostly this discharge will be blackish, bloody in color. So these are the important clinical features. Now from the sinus, once it moves into the orbital region, it will start showing some ophthalmic features like ptosis, proptosis, loss of your extra ocular muscle function, and vision disturbances. Okay, so these are the signs as it moves into your, as it moves into your orbital region. And a classical sign from a dental point of view is, like I said, a necrotic lesion on the hard palate or the nasal turbinate. Okay, that is your nasal concave. Then drainage of black pus from eyes are useful diagnostic signs for rhino-orbitocerebral mucormycosis. Okay, so that gives you a basic idea about rhino-orbitocerebral mucormycosis. Okay, this is very important from a dental point of view, because most of us will come across this kind, this type of mucormycosis. Now moving on to the next type, that is your pulmonary mucormycosis. Now pulmonary mucormycosis, again, it is the most common type of mucormycosis in people with cancer and in people who have had an organ transplant or a stem cell transplant. This is again followed by inhalation of your spores, gains entry into your lung parenchyma, resulting in ischemic necrosis and massive tissue destruction. Okay, what are the clinical features? The patient will present with fever, cough, chest pain, and shortness of breath. Okay, that is your pulmonary mucormycosis. Then you have gastrointestinal mucormycosis, more common among young children than adults, especially premature and low birth weight infants, less than 1 month of age. These patients would have had any some kind of antibiotics, surgery, or medication which can lower their body's ability to fight infection. Okay, so remember this, mucormycosis is an opportunistic fungal infection. Okay, that means it is waiting for your immune system to low down or to come down so that it can start attacking our body. Okay, what are the clinical features? Abdominal pain, nausea and vomiting, and gastrointestinal bleeding. Now coming to cutaneous type of mucormycosis. This, the fungi gains entry into your body through a cut in your skin, or some kind of trauma that has occurred in your skin, or after surgery, or after some kind of burns. Okay, what are the clinical features that you see in this? The most common type of clinical features is blisters or ulcer on the skin, black discoloration of the affected areas, swelling and pain in the sight. And it progresses to black ashes. Again, black discoloration you will see on your skin. Okay, so that is cutaneous mucormycosis. Then moving on to your last type, that is your disseminated mucormycosis. This occurs when through the blood, the infection or the fungi travels to different organs in your body. And like I said, the most commonly affected ones are your brain, spleen, heart and skin. So when it spreads through your blood to different parts of the body, that is known as disseminated mucormycosis. So with this, we have seen all types of mucormycosis. Okay, and for us from dental point of view, I feel we will be most commonly associated with rhino-orbitocerebral mucormycosis. Okay, now when to start suspecting as a clinician, as a general practitioner, when do you start suspecting? When patient comes to you with complaint of sinusitis, when patient starts complaining with sinusitis, one sign that should start triggering a thinking in your mind. Okay, one-sided facial pain, swelling, numbness. Patient will come with sudden toothache, loosening of teeth and jaw pain. And as it progresses a lot more, it gets more easier because then you have black discoloration of the palate and sometimes over the bridge of your nose. And as it moves to the orbital region, you will have signs like ptosis, proptosis, blurring visions and everything will start appearing. Okay, so these are the time when you should start thinking about or start even questioning what this is. Okay, now why this whole seminar was started now is because of this COVID situation. So why is there an increased occurrence of mucormycosis in COVID-19 patient? Why? Why should we start thinking about this all of a sudden now as dentists? Why should we be more careful? This is because of the alteration in the patient's immune system. Those patients who are COVID positive, their immune system has been hampered, has been altered. Why? What are the reasons? First one is prolonged usage of steroids and patients being on ventilator for a very long time. This weakens your immune system. Then once patients develop this, they can develop some secondary bacterial fungal infections. What do the doctors do? They will start giving them broad spectrum antibiotics and some kind of antifungal drugs. Now, the problem with this is that when you give broad spectrum antibiotic for a longer period of time, some antifungals for a longer period of time, they will kill out all the pathogenic microorganisms. Along with that, what will happen is that they will take out your normal common cells or normal protective bacteria, they will wipe it out. Common antifungal, the problem is, the most commonly used antifungal are useless against mucormycosis, or they actually do not have any effect against mucormycosis. So what does common antifungals do? They will take out all other fungal infections in your body. Now the mucormycosis alone, without any competition, ready to take on your body alone. Before, it was fighting with the other fungi to take a position in your body to affect you. But now everything is being wiped out by the doctors giving common antifungal, which they had to give because of some fungal infection. Now what it has helped is that it will help to the mucormycosis to thrive at without any competition. Okay, so it is again aiding in one way to the more faster spread of mucormycosis. Along with all these problems, if the patient has all those risk factors that we talked about, then the outcome is going to be fatal. Then the outcome is going to be fatal because now he is more compromised. He is having neutropenia, or he is having some kind of diabetic ketoacidosis or iron overload in his body, which will actually aid in the spread and faster dissemination of the fungi in your body. Okay, that is why we are now have to be worried why there is an increased occurrence of mucormycosis in COVID-19 patients. Okay. Okay, moving on to the next slide. So what is the pathogenesis associated with COVID-associated mucormycosis? What is happening? Almost similar pathogenesis. Basically, everything will come down to your neutrophil function. So basically, patients with COVID infection, those who have risk factors like hyperglycemia and those who are on corticosteroids and immunosuppressants, what happens is that the corticosteroids and immunosuppressants, they will impair your neutrophil function, migration, ingestion, and phagolysosome fusion. All of this is important in killing of the fungi. When there is an increased hyperglycemia, when the patient is uncontrolled diabetic, again, what happens is that from a molecular level, there is a protein known as glucose-regulated protein 78, which is expressed on the endothelial cells in your body. Now, what happens that with hyperglycemia, the expression of these receptors is increased. And what these receptors, they do is that they aid in much faster binding to the fungal hyphae so that this fungal hyphae can actually invade into the blood vessels at a much faster rate. Okay, along with that, again, hyperglycemia will cause PMN dysfunction, impaired chemotaxis. The neutrophil is not able to reach the fungi. Chemotaxis is a chemical gradient movement of your cell, especially your neutrophils and macrophages to the site of infection. Okay, certain chemicals are released, which will guide these neutrophils to reach there. Now that is lost or that is impaired. So that is not happening. And defective killing by these cells. Either oxygen dependent or oxygen independent killing is not happening properly. So again, overall, what is happening? It is impairing your immunity. So that is what is happening in COVID patients. Why they are affected? Why they are affected? Okay. Now, as oral healthcare providers, what should we do? Like as a periodontist or as a general dentist, what role can we play? Because we are not going to treat these patients for mucormycosis as such. Our role as general practitioners or other specialists, when we come across these cases, what our duty is to screen, suspect, and refer for immediate advanced treatment. That is a role that we have to do. We have to make sure that the patient is provided the best care at the right time without any delay, which is very, very important in COVID patients and in case of mucormycosis. Because like I said, it is a relentless disease and spreads at a very faster rate. So what should we do as a clinician when we sit in our clinic and when we see patients? What should we think about before we refer the patient or before we start suspecting the patient? So we have to screen first. How do we screen? We have to take a COVID history of the patient. We have to take a COVID history of the patient. First important thing. So first thing you ask the patient, when they come to your clinic, were they COVID positive or negative? Were they exposed to the virus or not? If yes, were they hospitalized? Very important, were they hospitalized? If they were hospitalized, what were the treatments that were given to them? Were they given steroids? Were they given any kind of broad spectrum antibiotics? Or were they given any antifungal drugs? That is first and foremost thing that you should ask them. Second, look for your predisposing or your risk factors, whether the patient is diabetic. If diabetic, is he uncontrolled? How do you get that? You cannot do it on a normal blood glucose levels. Go for an HbA1c. Ask whether the patient is on any immunosuppressive drugs. Any history of blood malignancy, very important, especially blood malignancies, and any post-transplant history. Again, so once you correlate these two together, once you correlate these together and you get many positive findings from this, then you move on to the next level of clinical examination. So you have taken a history, you have taken a history of predisposing factors. Once that is done, and if you are coming positive in those, you move to intraoral clinical presentation of the patient. Mobility of teeth without no other cause, no periodontal cause, but sudden mobility of the teeth. Draining sinuses. Ulcers and discoloration, especially blackish discoloration, non-healing wounds, exposed bones. Again, it should start ringing bell. Extraoral clinical presentation, tenderness in the sinus region. So do not always eliminate patients by saying that it's just bacterial sinusitis. No, at this time, in this and condition or era where we are living in COVID times, we have to be extra cautious. Tenderness of the sinus region, blocked nose, blackish, bloody discharge from your nose, ulcers, facial swelling, periorbital swelling, patient coming with headache and fever. Once you correlate all this, and if you start, so your screening is done now, and now you are suspecting it as a general practitioner, as any other specialist in dentistry, your role is now immediately to take a consult. Immediately call your maxillofacial friend or call your maxillofacial colleague who's working with you. Give them the history. Tell them that, see, I've come out with all these findings. I suspect, especially in India, you should start suspecting, because there are high number of cases. Where I come from, in last 5 to 6 years, we have not even reported a single case of mucormycosis in Seychelles. So we are at a much, safer area. But still, even when I do patients now in my clinic and my surgery, I always do a check of this, of the screening system, because it's very important. You cannot compromise your patient. The most important thing as a clinician, as a doctor, as a dentist, that you have to do is make sure that your patient is safe. That from your hands, whatever you can do best for the patient, you do that. Okay, so take this history, and once you correlate with your clinical findings, refer immediately for an advanced opinion and treatment. Because the diagnosis comes with a direct microscopy. So we cannot make a final diagnosis. We can come to a provisional diagnosis. And then it is the role of an oromaxillofacial surgeon to do further analysis, further clinical examination, and further blood profiles, further histology, to get a final diagnosis and start an aggressive treatment plan for these patients. So now, with this in mind, I hope you have got a clear idea about what mucormycosis is, what are its types, what is the pathogenesis, and as a clinician, what you should do. Now, with this, I would like to say thank you to everybody. But before I conclude, I would like to say, you should be always aware of the disease and its progress. Do not miss warning signs and symptoms. Always keep a high index of clinical suspicion. And like I said, do not overrule normal sinusitis as bacterial sinusitis, especially in context to immunosuppressors and COVID-19 patients. And do not hesitate to seek consult and start aggressive intervention. Why I'm saying all this is because there is not enough diagnostic tools now. To come to a diagnosis of mucormycosis, it is challenging. And there are a lot of predisposing factors now there out in the environment, which is favoring this. So we should always keep this in mind and do not lose your crucial time by hesitating to initiate treatment. From our point of view, it is to initiate a consult. Give a suspect and initiate a consult. Okay, so this is the references that I've used. You have a lot of references now online and lot of latest articles that have come on. So you can go online, and most of them are actually free in PubMed. So you can go through the latest article and come out with different cases and even its pathogenesis and the latest recent advances in management of this. Okay, thank you so much. I now give the floor to Dr. Pravish so that he can move on with the diagnostic techniques and the treatment plan for mucormycosis. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir. That was an extensive presentation, and you have educated all of us very well on this topic. Now, the next speaker is Dr. Pravish V. He is MDS in oral medicine, oral and maxillofacial surgery. In 2012, AIPG rank was 104 and Comedcare rank was 21. Sir has done his BDS from JSS Dental College, Mysore, and MDS from GDC, Kozhikode. Sir has been a speaker for various dental, oral and maxillofacial surgery forums. So now, sir, I hand over the stage to you.
Thank you, doctor, for your introduction, and it was well covered, Dr. Jerry. You have extensively covered how the disease progresses, and it is very important for us, being a dentist and a health worker, we should be knowing what is this disease and how it is going to progress and what are all the treatment modalities available for the disease. And I've seen some of these people thinking in a different way, saying that I'm not actually going to treat such people. So should I learn more about mucormycosis? it's not about treating alone. See, if you know about the condition, if you know about the mortality and morbidity associated with it, it will help you to educate, counsel, and refer the patient at the earliest. You know, the first person whom you might be the first person who is actually going to diagnose that the patient is having a mucormycosis, and you might be the person who is actually going to save life of that person. So it is very important. And my topic will be, or my presentation will be, mostly on how the clinical progress of rhino-orbito mucormycosis is going to take place. And I'll tell you about how the clinical progression is, and this will help you in identifying what kind of symptoms and signs you have to look for. And finally, I would be adding a word on how the entire disease is going to be treated. Okay, so the topic is on COVID-associated mucormycosis. So as Dr. Jerry had already said, this disease was there. It was there since long. It was there since, you know, the unhygienic days long back, when there was the hygiene was poor, when the diabetes mellitus incidence was more. So the immunocompromised conditions were more. All those times we used to get mucormycosis, but it was very, very, very rare. And present scenario, what is being changed? The COVID has come, the immunity is being suppressed like anything. And patients are on masks, they are on ventilators, they are having issues with the fungal spore being built up in their orofacial region. So that is going to cause mucormycosis. So I'll just add a few things on how it is. You have the spores everywhere, and it can be in a bread mold, mud, cow dung, or any unhygienic surface, and it can be ingested or it can be breathed in. And when it is being breathed in, it is obvious that it's going to get stuck somewhere in the nose, in the sinus, and it sometimes may go into the lung. So what was the problem if you ingest or if you are going to inhale these spores? In a normal person, we are also inhaling spores, but you know, normally, as Dr. Jerry had explained, our body fights it off. You know, our body fights it off, and when the normal commensals are there, then other fungal organisms are there. This particular fungus won't get enough iron or enough nutrients to, you know, grow. So normally, it, you know, spores enters and it goes off like that. Nothing happens, but in COVID, it may get affected. The fungus growth might take place. And what happens when it grows? It grows angio-invasively. So it has some filaments which is going to invade the blood vessels, and it is going to form a clot. And when clot is formed, it is like osteoradionecrosis and all. You know, that area will lose its blood supply. So it is like a necrotic piece of bone will develop, or a necrotic piece of soft tissue is going to develop. So that is what is basically going to happen. And the fungus is going to keep on growing, okay? So the association of COVID-19 with mucormycosis can be concomitant. You know, you will be still having COVID-19 and having a mucormycosis, or it can be sequential weeks or months after recovery. I get queries like, you know, sir, when can this happen? Say after 1 week or 2 weeks or after months, it can happen anytime. You know, after COVID, it takes a lot of time. See, your immunity is like a currency. You have spent the currency to prevent, or you have to fight the COVID disease. So you have spent the currencies. So next, your currencies has to build up, or your immunities has to build up to fight against another disease. So it will take time. So in meantime, if you are getting infected by mucormycosis, it may be weeks or months after it. There are chances that it can lead to a full-fledged infection. So predisposing factors were discussed very well by Dr. Jerry. So we should be knowing these predisposing factors. Along with that, the CDC, they had released last year itself, 2020 itself, they had released certain other association. There can be adhesive bandages which are tied onto your nose when you have a Ryle's tube, or to the mouth when you have a tube which is going to be connected to the ventilator machine. So these adhesive bandages sometimes remain there for a few days or weeks. Also, there can be a fungal mold in that. Then hospital bed sheets. You know, you cannot possibly change bed sheets of a bedridden patient every day. You cannot lift them up, move it around. So there can be problem with that. Negative pressure rooms, water leaks, poor ventilation, contaminated medical equipments. All these may be some factors which are, you know, associated with increase in amount of the fungus which you are being exposed to. Okay. So the virulence is, as Jerry doctor had said, it is depending on the iron availability. So in ketoacidosis, iron is available. The mucorals use iron and it grows. It thrives in iron. So it is going to have a very good growth. So clinically, it is usually presented as rhinoorbital, pulmonary, GIT, cutaneous, or it can be disseminated. So let's now talk about rhinoorbitocerebral mucormycosis. So we can keep it as rhinomaxillary and rhinoorbital and cerebral. So we can keep it as, you know, three ways, or you can keep it as two. You can keep it as rhinomaxillary, or you can keep it as rhinoorbitocerebral. So why is it so? What is the major factor which is, you know, having, or what is the major thing which you are finding in rhinoorbitocerebral mucormycosis? So I'll give some more details to what Dr. Jerry had pointed out. So the clinical presentation, obviously it's some discoloration. You can see a discoloration in this picture. You can see an ulceration there. You can see a discoloration there. So the initial change might be just this discoloration. If you can note, this discoloration is there. See? Evident discoloration is there from the adjacent mucosa. And later on, you know, within a few days, not few days, even one day or 2 days, you can see this ulceration which is forming. Okay. So that can be your initial presentation. So we need to watch out for discoloration first. So basically, discoloration takes place because of the blood supply which is being blocked. Okay. So the blood supply is being blocked. So it appears darker in color. Then if there is some venous obstruction, there will be cellulitis of face, or, you know, some swelling of face which might be there. In some cases, what happens is in the picture above, I showed you a palatal ulceration. In the picture below, I'm showing you an oroantral fistula. So in the picture above, what had happened was the ulceration started from palatal aspect and it is now progressing upwards. Now here in the oroantral fistula one, the picture which I have shown below, in this, what had happened is the bone gets eroded in the top, it gets eroded, and finally the buccal mucosa is opened up. So you have an oroantral communication now. So these are some of the clinical presentations. Now, another one thing is, you know, any foreign body in your, any place, there will be some pus collection. So usually the sinus is filled with pus. And sometimes there will be a pus opening like I've shown in this picture. And mostly the furcal bone gets involved. The furcal bone of 6 gets involved, and there will be a nagging pain, you know, something similar to your periodontal pain and all. Patient might be coming to you. You take IOPAs, you take, you know, IOPA might show you a bit of bone loss like in furcal abscess. Of kids. So in similarly, there might be a bone loss in the furcal region. It might be very minimal, and that might be the initial symptoms. So you might have a nagging pain, or you might have a very, very small discomfort. You might feel that something is wrong in this side, but, you know, clinically, when you look at, you look from teeth above. So you are looking at the teeth. You're looking for a caries. No, caries is not there. Abrasion is not there. Food impaction is not there, but actual pathogen has come from above. It has come from above downwards. So when you look from here, nothing would be seen. So that is one problem in initial cases. You know, people think that it is only a pain. There is nothing. There is no problem for the teeth. That's why the part where Jerry doctor had stressed, you need to suspect. High clinical suspicion should be there so that you get him thoroughly diagnosed. Okay. We'll come to what, how, or what ways we can diagnose. So this might be this small minute pus or minor pain must be the only thing which the patient has. So normal symptoms are any pain in that particular region. Numbness and swelling, you know, numbness occurs when a nerve is affected. It is angio-invasive. The blood supply to the nerve is blocked. So you will get a paresthesia just like when you inject any local anesthesia. Okay. And swelling happens when the veins are obstructed, the blood gets collected, or the drainage of the venous blood doesn't take place. Lymphatics get obstructed. There can be swelling due to inflammatory reaction also. Okay. And skin and mucosal discoloration is basically due to the blood supply being cut off. Okay. So nasal discharge. So it is very important. There might be a dark colored nasal discharge. Why? Because there is micro hemorrhages which happen when these things invade the smaller blood vessels. Okay. We have very high blood supply in face, but we have very small blood vessels. So there might be very fast invasion and there might be micro hemorrhages. Then double vision with pain, fever, skin lesion, it all depends on whether it has reached the blood stream and it has been disseminated or whether it has gone to the orbital region. So the symptoms depend upon the spread of infection. So let's talk about the spread of infection. So how does it spread? So this picture which I'm showing you, suppose I'll draw the fungus or the mold in a brown color. So it enters through the nose, isn't it? So you have been using a lot of supportive breathing, masks, or you have been in some BiPAP apparatus, non-invasive ventilations and all. So there is a lot of pressurized air which is going in. So the fungal mold might enter and it might harbor inside the maxillary sinus. It's a big sinus. It's the biggest sinus, and it might get harbored there. And when it gets harbored, what can happen is it can slowly invade the teeth. Slowly invade the teeth. And think about a periapical lesion there. If you have a periapical lesion there, this particular fungus doesn't actually really invade the cortical plates. It invades the cancellous part of it. It can easily invade through the cancellous part, but cortical part, it takes much time to breach. So if you have a periapical lesion and the cortical plate is thinned out, you're going to have a higher chance. Or sometimes what can happen is your root of your, the palatal root, especially of your upper first molar, is very close to the sinus. So there will be a very thin lining of bone. So in such cases, it can easily enter into the teeth. So this is the part where we should be focusing. So when we look from this aspect, from intraorally, when you're looking from this side, everything is clean. Nothing has happened. Patient has some difficulty, some pain. You will say that, okay, it is sensitivity. I'll give you this beautiful paste, which is going to reduce your sensitivity. We will try to prescribe that. Patient comes back after 2 days, says that the pain is reduced now. Probably it is reduced because the vessels or the nerves have been affected of the teeth and the pain is reduced, but I have this slight swelling here. I have some discomfort here. Then you'll think that, okay, my paste is working. The sensitivity has come down. So I should think of this line of treatment. It is not mucormycosis. No, ma'am, it is mucormycosis. So it progresses like that. Initial, some disturbance might be there. Next day, the nerve is cut off. So you might not have pain. Third day, you might have a swelling with pus discharge. Fourth or fifth day, it can spread to the entire maxilla. Why? Because entering the cortical plate is only the thing which delays it. Once it enters through the marrow, it is going to spread very fast. Now, let's see it in a different perspective. So if we view it from the front, so this is almost similar to the CT images which you get, isn't it? Your coronal section CT. So you can clearly see the maxillary sinus, which I'm outlining in red color. Then you can see the ethmoid sinuses here. Then you are supposed to have a frontal sinus here. And the sphenoid sinus will be behind it. Okay. So what is actually happening is your fungal mold is going to enter like this. the fungal mold is going to enter like this, and it is going to go inside the maxillary sinus through a meatus present there. So it is middle meatus, and it is going to enter the maxillary sinus, and it is going to harbor here somewhere. Okay, because of gravity, it is obviously going to come and harbor in the floor of maxillary sinus. Okay, now let's talk about how it can spread. So it is going to enter the cancellous bone through a small cortical breach. It can, you know, it can breach on its own, but you know, cortical spread is less. So now it has entered here. Now it can go like this, or it can go like this. So there is more marrow here. It will go like this. Now it is going to enter into your infratemporal fossa or your temporal fossa here. So it can go like that, or it can, you know, even this can get, this can enter into the ethmoid sinus directly. And from ethmoid, it can directly go into the orbit, or sometimes it can get harbored in the frontal sinus to the brain, or from the ethmoid sinus to the brain is a very easy path for it. Okay. So the common thing is it is going to appear on the maxillary part, and there the rhinomaxillary symptoms comes. And that is the part where we have to focus. Okay. Because as a dentist, we will be seeing cases like this. So even a sensitivity cost, or you think that it is a sensitivity case, don't ignore it. As I said, when you give the initial medicines, you give a anti analgesic and all, and the pain will go off in 2 days, and you will feel like, okay, or 2 days or the next day, the pain will go off. Why? Pain goes off because the nerve has been cut off. Okay, when the nerve has been cut off, there might not be pain. Later, what can happen is your socket gets infected, it loses its vascularity, and later what happens, it becomes dead. When it is dead, the body will try to somehow push it away, and it will create some pus, some disturbance, some inflammation, and that will happen in 2-3 days. And by then, it would have spread like how I explained. It would have spread all the way to the infratemporal or the temporal spaces, and it will invade vessels. Okay, so be sure that you check it very fast and properly refer it. See, in this picture, there is a more clearer view of how the roots are. See, sometimes the root is almost like this, with a thin cortical lining around it, very thin cortical lining around it. Okay, so it is very easy to enter into those spaces. Okay, so, and later from here, it goes into zygoma, from zygoma into the orbit, or in, back into the temporal or the temporal spaces. So it is going to progress. And what happens when it progresses? Suppose you get a lesion here. Suppose you get a lesion inside the inside your maxillary sinus. You can see these blood vessels. Okay, your infraorbital blood vessels is seen. Your posterior superior alveolar blood vessels is seen. Then there is a branch going into the orbital region. So it is angioinvasive. So first this thing is cut off. So when it is cut off, slowly this area will lose the blood supply. Then slowly it invades the other blood vessel. Slowly this area goes. Slowly this area goes. And within a short time, the entire maxilla blood supply is cut off. Very short time. Or it can go back and it can actually obstruct the blood supply, the main blood supply itself. So the entire maxillary blood supply is cut off. And it's kind of in a short duration. If it's a longer duration, somehow the body will try to create new blood vessels or something. But then what happens is, already an area of necrosis has come, the body cannot reverse it. Okay? It cannot be reversed. Okay? Yeah, some disturbance is there. Can you kindly mute yourself? So that's what is going to happen in this. And what can happen is sometimes, like what I said, is this region is cut off. The blood supply to this region is cut off, and your buccal mucosa and the palatal mucosa might be getting blood supply. Why? Because the greater palatine artery is going to supply here. The buccal mucosa gets supply from other region also. So you might not clinically see any discoloration, but the teeth would have gone dead and the socket would have gone dead. Okay. So the clinical progress of this disease depends on where the fungal growth is taking place. Okay. If it is taking place somewhere near here, the entire maxilla is going to be discolored. It is going to appear slightly bluish or blackish, darker color. Okay. So, but if it is not directly affecting that particular major blood vessel, only that particular socket is going to get affected. Similarly, now I've shown you a picture of orbital cellulosis. So once the lesion or once the disease spreads backwards, what it's going to do is it's going to cut off these vessels, these veins of orbit. So when the veins are obstructed, there will be edema around the lid and there will be cellulitis associated with this. And imagine it going and cutting off this particular artery. It is a major artery to the ophthalmic artery, which is going to supply the eyeball. So your vision is gone. Your vision is gone. And this is the one which is going to supply the muscles. So the vision is gone, the muscles will become dead and the whole eyeball is going to go dead. So that's going to be a major problem. So this disease, if not checked, and the spread can be from the maxilla to zygoma to orbit because it spreads through the marrow. So this was explained by Dr. Jerry. So how the ancho invasion and the growth of this particular fungi takes place. Okay, now just have a look at, you know, this was a picture of a person's teeth which was extracted. If you can see towards your right side, this area is dead. It's gone. It's dead and there is no blood after the extraction. And now this area on the left side, which I'm marking in a violet color, it has bleeding. So keep this in mind. When you get a patient who was COVID positive, probably you have to take history for everyone. Keep this in mind. Maybe months later after COVID, he comes to you and he has a dental caries. It's very evident that there is some disease there and the patient is telling pain. You extract, don't find blood. It's a medical emergency. Refer them to a proper center, get it diagnosed. Okay. So remember that if there is no blood in the socket when you have extracted, it could be mucormycosis. Okay. What other condition you get like this? You can get a similar scenario in an osteoradionecrosis, osteomyelitis. You might get a similar scenario, but it is more chronic, you know. So the body tries to somehow adjust it. It somewhere it gets new blood vessels and it tries to compensate. Okay. So there will be slight pus formation, but there won't be evident, you know, loss of blood like this in any other case. So this is peculiar in mucormycosis. So initially there might be a discoloration like this. As I said, it might not be there also. But when they come to you, there might be a discoloration like this or multiple small petechiae, you know, small spots of extravasation of blood or, you know, bluish discoloration might be there. Then it can peel off like this. Okay. And don't think that it is a vitamin deficiency. You have to give some vitamin tablet and all. And later it can be an established communication where you can see the bone, bare bone. Okay. And one thing is you might not actually have the fungus here, this areas, you might not be having fungus here. So there is no point in cutting a tissue from here and sending for biopsy. Sometimes you might not get anything. Why? Because this happens secondary to the infection. Why? The invasion, the angioinvasion has taken place and the blood supply is cut off. So here you are getting only the dead tissue. You might not get the fungus here. In initial stages, later fungus might spread through this region, but your biopsy diagnostic should be from the maxillary sinus region because the disease has come from sinus. Okay, so we'll come to that. So to establish a diagnosis, can we do that in our setup? There is slight limitation. So it is a medical emergency. So when you suspect, you immediately start liposomal amphotericin B or any other assaults, which are the drugs of choice for this thing. Because it is a, you know, you weigh the risk and benefit ratio, you start it directly. Because this disease is going to progress very bad. So you start it directly. Then what else can you do? Radio imaging for CAM or COVID associated mucormycosis. So why, as a dentist, we should know this. We should be at least able to educate the persons. I'll tell you why this is important, and you don't do much of CT in this. So you do MRI PNS with brain contrast. Why? Because the earlier lesion can be identified through MRI solely. Even the small defect in your interradicular bone or the fungal growth within the interradicular bone and some changes there can be identified with your MRI. So why not a CT? CT is good for your pulmonary mucormycosis, but not for your rhino-orbitocerebral. Why? Because it takes the lesion, more bone destruction should be there for the lesion to be visible in a CT. So preferably go for an MRI. You can take a CT, CBCT and all later. If the bone involvement is clinically established, you can go for all those things because it will tell you, it will give you an idea of how to surgically debride and all. Okay, so initially one is MRI. Then refer them to an ENT surgeon. Why? The biopsy has to be taken through a endoscopy. Why? The lesion is inside the maxilla. It is inside the maxilla and it has progressed. So just check this picture. In this, they have shown a picture in which there is a normal left side and a mucormycosis in the right side. So what they are seeing is something which we see in palate. What we see in palate is there is ulceration. What there is inside the sinus is also ulceration along with some pus discharge or some blackish discoloration like it is seen in this picture. So you have to do a diagnostic nasal endoscopy. They take the tissue. Then how do you establish a diagnosis? So you have fungal stainings, culture, and spectrometry. So there are certain tests which you can do. The potassium hydroxide test is very simple, very easy. You can get the results very immediately. So you put it, this preparation is used and it clears the specimen, making the fungal elements more visible. And direct microscopic examination, you can clearly see the fungus. So establishing a diagnosis is very easy in this. Sometimes you have to grow the culture. So culture might take 3 or 5 days, but it is not absolutely required because the hyphae seen in the microscope would be more than enough to establish a diagnosis. So ICMR, so most of my presentation is based on the ICMR guidelines, Indian Council of Medical Research, because we have this disease under notifiable diseases based on the Epidemic Act, which we have. So according to that act, we have to follow the guidelines. So any treatment anywhere, it has to be based on these guidelines. So I have to limit my presentation based on this guideline. There are other guidelines available, but mostly it is same. Okay. So what they have told is, primary thing is underlying hyperglycemia has to be controlled. So things to do, they have divided it into things to do and things not to do. That is a guideline which they have given. So in that, controlling hyperglycemia is very important. Post-discharge also, blood glucose level has to be monitored. Steroid usage, then use clean sterile water in humidifiers, use of antibiotics and antifungals. As Dr. Jerry had mentioned, you know, other antifungals, which are, you know, some of the antifungals are not effective against mucors. So what happens is it is going to destroy the other organisms. So what happens when other organisms are destroyed, this mucor is going to get all the nutrients which is required and it can easily grow. Okay. So such antibiotics and antifungals, which are heavily used in some cases, should be judiciously used. Okay. And ICMR thinks not to do. So don't miss any warning signs. As I said, even a dental sensitivity, sometimes you give medicine, you give a paste, it goes off in 2 days. I told you the reason. It is not because of your paste has acted or your medicine has acted. It is because that the nerve is cut off after 2 days or 1 day. The nerve is cut off. So pain is going to disappear, but patient is going to come back with a bigger problem. Okay, so you understand the seriousness of the situation. So don't miss any warning signs. So do not consider all cases with blocked nose to be bacterial sinusitis, especially in context of immunosuppressors and COVID-19 immunomodulators. So anything, because I said the maxillary sinus is the place where it can harbor, and anything related to maxillary sinus, look into it with high suspicion, and do not hesitate to seek aggressive intervention. So when you need to do a culture or you need to do a microscopy, you need to get a sample of the fungus. And I, as I told, don't try from intraoral. Rougher, get it from the endoscopic part. Why? Because the fungus is there and the outcome only has come in the palate. Okay. And don't lose crucial time to hesitate initial treatment. So treatment is controlling diabetes is the main part. Steroids you have to reduce. Other immunomodulators you have to reduce. And there is no antifungal prophylaxis which we need. Prophylaxis in the sense, we take some medicines to prevent this mucormycosis from coming. So you don't do that. You don't need to do that. Okay. So the treatment is medical and surgical. Okay. So medically, install a peripherally inserted central catheter line. This is based on ICMR guidelines. Maintain adequate systemic hydration and liposomal amphotericin B. So let's see what these things are. So peripherally inserted central line catheter. Why is it so? So central line catheter is a catheter which goes all the way into the superior vena cava. You can see in this picture. You can see in this picture, it goes like this all the way here. So why so? So this disease is it's going to cause, it's angioinvasive and it's going to cause problems in smaller veins. So to prevent that, it is better you give a central, okay? Yeah. So prevent that, you can give a central line. I can come back to your doubts. I'm getting doubts in the chat box. We'll come back to that after this presentation, okay? You can meantime post it in that chat box. And this is why we give or why this is being advised. Peripherally inserted central line catheter, and you have to give a good amount of hydration also. Now, how does amphotericin work? So it is going to interact with ergosterol in the fungal cell wall, and it forms a pore. Pore means that opening. And now what is going to happen? Potassium and other small molecules migrate through the pore, and it is going to cause cell death. So that's why we prefer amphotericin. Now, some of you will think that what is liposomal amphotericin B? So amphotericin is a highly toxic drug. It's a highly toxic drug. We make a liposomal preparation of amphotericin B to reduce its toxicity. Okay, so that's the name, liposomal amphotericin B. That's why we say liposomal amphotericin B is given. So some other drugs also are there. Basically, it's azole group of drugs. This also is going to act on ergosterol synthesis, and it is going to cause the cell it is going to inhibit the fungal growth. So either intravenously you can give, or a few drugs you can give orally. So the basic guideline of ICMR still recommends amphotericin B. What about the surgical treatment? Now, surgical part is to remove the necrotic material and also the fungal growth associated with the necrotic material. So it can be from a single or, you know, whatever teeth has been affected, extraction of that to a much, much extensive debridement. So I'll just show you what can happen. So suppose one teeth is involved. So what we will be doing is we will be removing that one teeth. So it is very rare to get a one teeth involved. You might get a posterior maxilla involved. So I have removed the posterior maxilla. So this is a partial maxillectomy, and it is obvious that the lesion has started from the sinus. So I need to remove the sinus, the floor of sinus. So there is an evident oro-antral communication, oro-antral fistula form. Now, what can happen is sometimes the lesion is more extensive. So you might end up removing more of the maxilla. So it might be a partial maxillectomy. Sometimes what can happen is more involvement is there. Just one infraorbital blood vessel, if it is affected, this much of area can be going for necrosis. So this will be a hemimaxillectomy, and sometimes it can go and extend into the orbital walls. When the orbital walls are involved, you have to go for orbital walls along with the orbital content. So you may have to go for an extensive resection of the orbit also. And what sometimes can happen is this, what I told is regarding the rhinomaxillary progression, the rhinomaxillary part, the nose and the maxillary part. Sometimes it can be rhino orbital cerebral or rhino orbital part alone. So if the globe is involved, you do a orbital excentration. So excentration means you will remove the orbital wall, you will remove the eyeball, you will remove the eyelids also. Okay, so this can be very extensive. The morbidity cost is very high. But if you hesitate to do surgery, the lesion is going to spread. And ultimately, it is going to spread till it reaches, or it is going to, or ultimately, it's going to affect the brain. So to prevent it from getting into the cerebrum, we need to cut it off or to remove the particular lesion. So that is the basic treatment. So it is a combined effort. You treat it medically and you treat it surgically. Now the team for this is a combined team of infectious specialists, medicine, intensivist. Then you have a maxillofacial surgeon, ENT, ophthal, and a dentist. So it is a big team which is going to look after this patient. And now the role of dentist is sometimes, or if any patient comes, we need to screen. See, now the post-COVID or the complaints or the patient which are post-COVID, we should have it in our history or in your case history. We should be asking for post-COVID history also. So it was not much importance previously. We never used to consider COVID as a disease previously. Corona was supposed to be a very small one paragraph, which we have read in, I think, microbiology and all. But now in present scenario, coronavirus is a big infection, and the COVID-19 is something which we should include in our case history taking. Why? Because in case history, if you suspect the patient to be post-COVID and having some dental symptoms, you have to be very cautious to, first rule out whether it is mucormycosis. That's what they say. Whenever a patient walks in, think that this is mucormycosis. Okay. And you have to keep a high suspicion. That's what they say. And how do we, conclude or come to a diagnosis? That's why I was telling about the diagnosis part. You have to send them to a center or ENT personnel to get the biopsy done. And as I said, see, intraoral biopsies has a limitation because the fungus or the fungal growth might not have reached there. The fungal growth might be more evident in the maxillary area because that's where it starts from. So endoscopic diagnostic nasal endoscopy should be done. And in the treatment part, our role actually, maxillofacial surgeons do a bit of resection. Some of them do the orbital excentration also. The prosthodontist is going to help the patient's rehab. So intraoral obturator, eye prosthesis, all those things. So the dentist has a key role in identifying the rhinomaxillary one, and keep it in mind, any small sensitivity also. Never think that it is going to be cured with our paste or our analgesics which we are going to give. So I am going to conclude it with this. As a dentist, we should be aware of the disease and its progress. Okay, you should be aware of the disease and progress. You should be able to educate people about how bad it can become if it is untreated. Okay, prompt attention to any symptoms, any signs and symptoms which you see. High index of clinical suspicion. Establish the diagnosis early. And before the diagnosis comes or the result comes, you can start the full dose of liposomal amphotericin B. It is given 4 to 6 weeks. Protocol-based strategy by a multidisciplinary team and a prioritized approach may be the key to success. So with that, I am winding up my session. So I would look into that questions which has come. Yes. Okay. So there are a few questions. I just want to know the risk factor. Okay. So Dr. Gopika has asked, I just want to know the risk factors of mucormycosis in a patient who are in ventilator ICU. Kindly explain further. I've seen an article stating the patients are receiving prolonged oxygen support are more susceptible. So I did mention about, the CDC's guidelines, which was released last year itself. In that they had talked about, possible contamination of medical equipment, your hospital bed, your ventilation, lack of ventilation, all those things they had mentioned there. So that could be a probable reason. There are many other hypotheses which I don't want to discuss because those has not been proved, like the nitrogen carrying containers are being converted into oxygen, nitrogen. In nitrogen, this is going to thrive, the organism is going to thrive. So the containers will have more mucorals. All those are certain hypotheses which has been being discussed over these days. So that I am not I've not put in my presentation. Then something else. What is other choice of drugs other than amphotericin, as there is lack of drug? See, the lack of drug is being now the procurement of this drug is centralized. So the government is trying to provide it. So there is or there was some shortage of drug. I think it is being corrected. And I want to add that why these drugs are short. These drugs have been used very very rarely. So the production of these drugs is very less. So in present scenario, you have a sudden surge of cases. North May, you have 1,500 cases. There's an explosion of cases, and all of them require amphotericin B. So the production has been now ramped up, and the government is procuring it from abroad, and the government is going to distribute it. So amphotericin is there if the swelling is due to. Okay, next is. If the swelling is due to mucormycosis, will it reduce with normal amoxicillin course? No. Amoxicillin is going to act on bacterial cell wall synthesis. So it has a particular mode of action, which is not going to be applicable with the fungal. So the swelling may reduce because of multiple reasons. See, any small soft tissue penetration or soft tissue opening, the cellulitis or the pus is going to drain off and swelling will go. It has no relation with the inflammation getting reduced has no relation with the amoxicillin or whatever drug we are giving. Okay, what are the, I think KOH is used in diagnosis part. I told that Dr. Grency has asked that. Is this disease seasonal? Yes, this disease is not exactly seasonal, but moisture, this mold is going to grow more. So in such scenarios where the place where the person is, I'm not talking in associated COVID-associated mucormycosis, I'm talking mucormycosis in general. So if there is any unhygienic surroundings where moisture is there, the fungus is growing more, and you are living in such conditions, you have a chance to get, but then also your immunity level should be less. So I was not talking about COVID-related mucormycosis, general mucormycosis, okay? It can be seasonal, as in if the moisture is more, it can be. So how are steroids related to it? Somebody has asked, steroid is going to lower the immunity of our body. The neutrophils are the first ones to fight with this fungus. So when there is no fighting thing, the immunosuppression is there. There is no fighting against this fungus. The fungus is going to grow. So next, somebody has asked, a little bluish colored heart palate in a fair skin toned patient without any symptoms of COVID is normal. Yes, it can be normal, but it is normal. But your normal thing will have same color on the other side of palate. Okay. So here, mucormycosis usually is clinically presented on one side initially. Okay. So when the color is changed in one side, you should be noting that. Okay. So can it occur in mandible? Yes, there was a case report. Interestingly, today morning I was listening to a mucormycosis presentation, and they had a case where it had affected into the mandible also. Okay, is it possible to reverse initial lesion with only medication without surgical excision? Possibly no. There should be a debridement also. The already some destruction has been taken place. That's why you had some symptoms, or you know, you have identified the disease. Without destruction, you cannot identify the disease. Okay. There should be some way, some destruction has taken place, and the area which is destructed is dead. So amphotericin B is fully going to kill the fungus, but this dead tissue has to be removed. It's like a root stem in your mouth. And what is going to happen in mouth, you know, somehow it remains like that because somehow it will remain for, you know, longer time without any infection. But when it is in maxillary sinus, there will be high sinus discharge, there will be pus, there will be foul smell, and all those things are again going to help a fungus to grow. So that necrotic area you need to remove. Okay, can I talk about reconstructive surgery for this? Yes, reconstructive surgery has to be done. You can do a free fibular grafting. You can do, you know, it is like any other reconstructive surgeries. So cancer surgeries, which we do based on the, there's certain classification for prosthesis also. Based on that, you can give a prosthesis or you can go for a extensive reconstructive surgery. But possibly after the disease is controlled, after the patient gains his immunity back. So we don't want to risk immediate, you know, immediate grafting and all. We don't want to risk because the patient's immunity level is already less. So let him recover. We can think of it as a second surgery. Can we consider nasal swab used for RT-PCR as one of the causes for mucormycosis? That is a very good this thing. But, you know, at the time of collecting swab, even if the fungus is ingested into the nose, if his or her immunity is good, it is going to be kicked out. So those things are there. But I think the nasal swab is, it should be pre-sterilized. So that...
It normally comes in a pre-sterilized
pouch. Yeah, it comes in a pre-sterilized.
If it is the proper one.
Yeah. So even for mild symptom, where there is initial discoloration, can we start with amphotericin, doctor? Will the patient have a burning sensation of entire mouth because of this disease? See, a burning sensation, like that is dysesthesia. You know, something happens to the nerves, you may have a burning sensation. But typically, the burning sensation can be of palate. It cannot be of entire mouth because of this disease. But you cannot say. It all depends on which part of the nerve which part of the blood vessel it is going to affect. So even for mild initial discoloration, send the patient for an MRI and nasal endoscopy. MRI and nasal endoscopy. Okay. That should be the primary thing to be done. And amphotericin, you cannot just start like that. Patient has to be admitted. Patients, it should be given as IV. So it is not an easy drug to give. We have to look for other systemic problems patient has, because this drug itself is toxic. Okay, wearing mask for a long time may cause infection. Long time might cause infection, but you know, you are supposed to clean the mask and use. Sometimes some people might use cloth mask, which is lying like that for so many days, they don't wash it. So that can harbor a lot of fungal growth. Okay, so that can happen. Yes, Roshni, Dr. Roshni has asked whether people having iron supplements have higher chance, very high chance. I mean, along with other immunosuppression, if they are having iron supplements, the growth of this fungus is depending on the excess iron which you have in your body. If you have excess iron, this fungus is going to grow like anything. So in diabetic ketoacidosis, there is free iron available in serum. So that is one reason why in diabetes, we find it in a higher thing. Okay. So next is there any other causative agent which one should take care of most common in our daily lifestyle? See, the most common fungal infection is candida. Okay, you don't keep your mouth or your oral cavity clean, you can have a candidal infection. That is more common. We might also have seen candida in patients patients with severe diabetes mellitus, poor oral hygiene and all. Okay, so that is a causative agent for a different kind of fungal infection. Okay, how to manage the case in absence of amphotericin B when emergency arrive in dental clinic? So it is not a treatment which is done in clinic. It is a treatment. It is a multi-approach treatment. Now in my place, they have a team which is headed by the district collector, and the head of department of oral and maxillofacial surgery, ENT, infectious disease, and the medical superintendent all are involved in that team, and they any cases are being reported or being admitted is being reported to them, and they have a look at the treatment protocol. So it is not a thing that amphotericin B you can apply locally and you can treat this disease. No, amphotericin B has to be given IV, and there are a lot of parameters which we need to actually check, especially because of the toxicity of this drug. Okay, person who is vaccinated can get this disease. This disease can be there for any person who is immunocompromised, regardless of whether they are being vaccinated, they have COVID or not. You know, this is an opportunistic infection which can be there for any such problems which is going to compromise your immunity. Okay, so I think I've taken all the questions. Anything more? Either to me or to Dr. Jerry. Yeah,
sir, are there any prophylactic drug which we can take?
No. That is very important. You don't give any prophylactic drug. So what do you mean by prophylaxis? Prophylaxis is the disease is not there. You're starting a drug. Okay, the disease is not there. You're starting a drug. You cannot give amphotericin just like that because amphotericin is going to cause other systemic problems. So other antifungal, as Dr. Jerry had mentioned, many other antifungal are not active against mucor. So what happens is you have, you know, fungus is there all around. You have fungus here and there, but you have minor quantity. This antifungal is going to kill that funguses. Then you take antibiotics. You take amoxicillin, moxiclav, or, you know, just step it up. You can give a very high-end antibiotic. It is going to wipe out the normal flora. See, there are three people in a room and there is plenty of food there. So it gets shared with these three. When there is only one person and plenty of food, what happens? This person is going to sit and eat that food, isn't it? So this is what is going to happen. When you give antibiotics and other antifungals, everything is going to die except mucor. Mucor is going to enjoy there. It is going to have that iron. It is going to grow. And when the immunity is less, possibly the person cannot fight against it. So that's what's going to happen. And prophylactic drugs, we cannot give. You have to first have an idea of whether it is a mucormycosis. And you can initiate the treatment when you feel that it is a mucormycosis, even before the diagnosis comes. Okay, you don't give prophylaxis. Means, I'll tell you what prophylaxis actually means. You give everyone some drug after they are post-COVID. You say, ki, you eat this so that you will never get mucormycosis. So there is unfortunately no drug like that. Okay, so you cannot give like that. Okay, yes. I think few more questions are there. What complications are common for death after surgical procedures, sir? What complications are common for death? I didn't get that question, Dr. Semina. Can you just can you reframe that question? I didn't get the point.
I think she's asking for the surgical complications that can lead to death during maxillectomy, hemi or total maxillectomy.
Leading to death. It's unlikely due to the surgery alone. Death can be due to many other issues. You know, you can get cardiac arrest during a surgery. You can get other reasons. But due to the maxillectomy and all, death is very uncommon.
If you're asking about how normal death is happening, it's again due to disseminated mucormycosis. Because it is affecting multiple organs. So multiple organ failure.
That's what she has asked. I mean, the most common reason for morbidity.
Yes.
So,
organ failure.
And as Dr. Jerry's session, if you had missed it, he was pointing out that this organism is going to thrive in highly vascular areas. So you have, unfortunately or fortunately, you have very good blood vessels in the face. It is very good. When you do any surgeries, it will heal excellent. That's why when you do, you know, you remove the entire maxilla also, it heals very well. That is because of the high vascularity. But this high vascularity, unfortunately, in mucormycosis, this thing is going to help the organism. So the growth of organism or the spread of disease is more more in such scenarios. Okay, so it is going to affect the cerebrum, and that can be the most common reason for the mortality. Any questions which we have missed? If we have missed any of your questions, can you just kindly repost it, or you can ask it, or you know. So I think we are almost done. Yes, if chronic headache or dry cough, chronic headache. I don't think chronic headache is related to this thing. Ask for the pre-COVID history also. But you know, as they say, give a high suspicion. Okay. Kindly tell me instructions for the patients to maintain their oral hygiene during COVID. Okay. Now, COVID can be divided into different categories. You know, the normal COVID person is like anyone. You can brush your teeth. Nothing else to be done. You can have a mouthwash. But the scenario changes when he is on a oxygen support also. He is very much healthy. He can do things on his own. But first we go from non-invasive then to invasive ventilation. So non-invasive ventilation is a mask which is kept and high pressure oxygen is going in. You might have heard of CPAP, BiPAP and all. So those cases also the patient can maintain their oral hygiene, but in certain cases they might be very tired, or you know, they might be having some problem to get out of this thing, or to brush on their own. Next comes the invasive ventilation, when you put an endotracheal tube and the patient is in the ventilator and you have given a skeletal muscle relaxant and all. Those cases, usually the oral hygiene is maintained or managed by the nursing staff. It is universal when the patient is in ventilator. We use mouthwashes. Sometimes the suctioning and cleaning of oral cavity is done by the medical professionals. Okay. So other than that, nothing specific to it. After invasive, chances spreading through spore. Dr. Abdul, there is no chance that it is going to spread. Okay. Even if the spore comes to your body, unless you are immunocompromised, nothing is going to happen to you. Okay. That doesn't mean that I'm going to eat that fully fungal this bread. You know, your normal bread, if you keep it for 2 days, this same mucor is going to grow on it. So if I'm saying that my immunity is good, that doesn't mean I'm going to eat that bread. No. So you need to be, normal hygiene you have to maintain, but the chances of spreading through any droplets is very, very less, or it's not there. Time period for oral methods. Time period. This time period concept comes when you're thinking about incubation period. Okay. Like in virus. So this doesn't have time period. The virus is different. The fungus is different. Fungus is a living organism which comes inside the maxillary sinus, and it is going to start growing inside the sinus. It is going to have a family of its own, and it is going to eat or it is going to have iron from your body, and it is going to grow. So as and when it grows, the symptoms come. It doesn't have a particular day when the symptoms starts. It is that is therefore that when the when it is an incubation, or when there is an incubation period, you have a particular date or a day. Okay, so there is no time period as such, and particularly for oral manifestation, the manifestation can spread. Okay, it can be oral or it can be nasal. So nasal congestion and nasal symptoms, be very particular about such patients who have nasal symptoms and oral issues. How fast we need to advise patient? Very fast, you have to advise. Unfortunately, it is not a medicine-driven disease control. You have to surgically intervene also. Okay. So is that done for the day? Time period? Okay. I think we have covered most of the things, isn't it?
There's a last question that has come in. What may be the leading reason that such rare diseases have increased dramatically in the second wave of COVID-19 that we have already talked about? Because the patients are more immunocompromised now, extremely immunocompromised. So that is why we are seeing such increase in the dramatic cases of mucormycosis.
I'll also add on to one thing. The number of cases is increasing. The number of COVID cases also have increased. There have been a huge increase in cases in the second wave. So mucormycosis was reported in the first wave as well, and it was reported elsewhere, you know, in other countries also during the first wave. But that was minor. You know, that is because the numbers of cases reported of COVID was less. So relatively, you know, you have a lesser mucormycosis case or COVID-associated mucormycosis. Okay. So this wave, we had a very huge explosion of COVID cases. So your relative ratio of mucormycosis also is going to increase. Methylene blue while delivering oxygen as a precaution against mucormycosis. I'm not sure about it. Dr. Jerry?
No. I'm just hearing that role of methylene blue.
There is a different thing. You know, when the mucormycosis is actually affected, there are studies and there are certain articles on hyperbaric oxygen therapy. But that is basically to control the the necrosis of bone, not control the disease as such. Okay. So that is same like we give in osteoarthritis necrosis and all. You might have heard of that HBO, hyperbaric oxygen chamber, the 30 dives, 20 dives, 60 dives and all. You might have read in textbooks. So similar thing can be done, but it is not under any, it's not given in any other guidelines. There are studies on it. Any more questions?
No, I think we are done.
I appreciate the people, you know, we had around 70. Now it is at least 50 people are staying back to actually hear something. Dr. Hilary?
Yes, sir. It was a really beautiful and informative session.
So, shall we wind up? Any of you want to ask something, you can raise your hand. We can unmute you. Or we can... We have allowed participants to unmute yourself. You can unmute and ask if there is anything you want to know. And... okay, we are getting a lot of feedback. Reason that out of population is being. Thank you so much. Okay. I think this will be available. This entire session will be available in Dr. Hilary's as well as Focus Future Industries YouTube page. Somebody is asking to share the PPT. So it is always good for you to watch the video. Isn't it?
Yes, sir. We'll upload it soon on Dento Woman YouTube channel and Focus MDS as well.
I think, doctor, you can just type the your YouTube channel in this.
I'll just share the link with them, sir.
Yeah, that would be better for them. So, a casual question, doctor. Do you think Kerala is step ahead than other states of India in such pandemic management? We are a step ahead, or the Kerala is a step ahead. There are many reasons to it. We have not, the population is more aware, the population is less, we have more medical facilities, and I think the most number of government medical facilities are there in Kerala, and the access to it, very important. We have a very good access. See, I've worked in rural Karnataka, I know how bad the access is from one place to another place. So we have a very good access, and we were very lucky to have the second wave slightly, you know, late. When we had the first wave itself, we had the maximum number of cases very late. So we had much more time to prepare. And the second wave also, we were late because, the cases increased later, you know, when we compare with the rest of India. So we had oxygens ready, and by then all the medical colleges had a pressure swing activated oxygen generators. Okay. And most of them had the plants, and I think one or two still has to construct the pipeline. So we didn't have oxygen deficiency. We didn't have a deficiency of beds. So even in my place, Calicut, a new COVID hospital has come up. So all those things, definitely we are doing well. I think most of the things are repeat questions. Aggravation.
There's one question on aggravation of mucormycosis because of geographical area. It's not more geographical, it's more socio-economical. It's become from where, which strata you come from. If you are living in a very what you crowded place, a moist environment, the chances of you having the mucormycosis spores is much higher there. So those patients will have, remember this, mucormycosis is normally present in the environment and mostly present in most of our body. It is only that when we are immunocompromised that it is taking the toll on us. So especially it's not geographical, it's the socioeconomical strata or the socioeconomical status of people which will actually expose them to more of this condition and then the immunocompromised status. Okay, I think that's it. That will clear everything. The rest is...
Aggravation of mucormycosis, actually, when you're talking about geographical region, Kerala should see more surge of cases in the coming monsoon because, you know, when the rain is there, the moisture is there, and when you have a house which is made of more of wood and all, because we have this wooden window panes, wooden doors and all. So all those things are actually going to help the fungal mold to grow. So whether it has to go inside your nose or inside your mouth, that you should, you know, decide. You can still maintain hygiene, okay? And that geographical way, if you're thinking, that won't be the cause. The cause is, as doctor had said, socioeconomic, when unhygienic situations, immunocompromised conditions, all those things are more to be taken into consideration. So I think regarding the other questions, we have already discussed that. You can go to ma'am's YouTube page, or you can go to our YouTube thing for video of the same session, which will be explaining that those other questions which have just come, isn't it? Hope to clean our nose. I think, you know, better don't clean it unless you're professional. You might actually push the fungal molds into the middle meatus. So we don't have to do it. Keep your face clean. And
the body does it on your own for yourself.
Yeah, you have nasal discharge for that reason. You have any, yes, exactly. You put the paper inside your nose, the discharge increases. Okay. So that thing, the body will take care of. Anything more?
Okay.